So today will be final lecture in that year, and I want to conclude with some equations. The main equations in general relativity. So we consider the following action. This is a scalar curvature. G is a determinant of this metrical tensor. Here indices I and J goes from 0, which is time, to 3, which is spatial coordinates. Then what is this? This is standard volume form. Here minus we put here because if we consider metric of the following view, dx0 squared minus d1, 2, 3, or minus, it doesn't matter because this metric is four-dimensional. In both ways, its determinant will have negative sign, so we should multiply it by minus to consider the square root of it. I hope everybody remember that if you want to write down some volume form or on some submanifold, you should multiply this so what we have here, what is d omega? D omega is just dx0, dx1, dx2, dx3. Or you can even don't put here which product, just this this four form. But as our space, it has some non-trivial geometry, you should multiply this this four form by this factor to get really volume form. So we integrate this thing over the R1, 3 spacetime, and we want to find those metrics for which variation of this functional is zero. So we variate this functional along all the metrics. But so you consider this G is for gravity. This is not for metric, because there will be also another functional for the equation for energy impulse tensor. So you want we want to find those metrics for which the variation of this very very natural action is zero. So а где тряпка? I'm sorry, but I have to find something to clean the blackboard. Now we can find the variation of this functional. So it's more or less straightforward, but there is some So what was the scalar curvature? Scalar curvature is the convolution of the Ricci tensor, which is this. Here we have the convolution of that d omega. So we have actually three multipliers here. All of them depends on the components of the metrical tensor, which we consider to be the variables. So this is the inverse matrix for the metrical tensor. D variation of minus G plus, so this is for that, this is for that, and the last one is Ricci d omega. Now let us understand what is this. So it is easy to see that this is variation you consider just like a derivative, so it's standard formula for the variation of square root minus g, and here we have multiplied by this. This is obvious, and minus. The next formula is not so obvious, but it is easy to understand that it is correct. So actually here we will consider as variables not the component of the metric tensor, but the components of the inverse metric tensor. This will be our variables. So it is easy to understand that there is no difference if you consider as variables the components of this matrix either of that one. So G here is a determinant, yes? And when you consider the determinant of the matrix, you probably remember that formula that the determinant of the matrix A11, A12, A21, A22, and so on. So what is equal for? You can consider the A11, and it is multiplied by what?
A22 and B.
so you can see, you can consider the formula for the determinant when you consider it splitting by the column, for example. Yes. So this will multiply by what? By the determinant of Z matrix. So it, we will call it, for example, A11. Yes? Okay. So this is, you can forget about this column and that column and consider this smaller matrix and its determinant. The determinant of this smaller matrix will be multiplied by that that component. Then minus, for example, if we consider the column A12 multiplied by the determinant of the matrix that you will get by forgetting that row and that first column, and we will call this A to 1 and so on. Yes, so this, this will be the intertwining of the signs. Okay. And what is the components of the, this will be matrix, for example, A. Yes. And what will be the components of the inverse matrix? Exactly, the this big A's will be the components of the inverse matrix. So here you should put A11, A21, A12, and so on. But also you should, what should you also do? No. Transpose maybe, but you also should divide by the determinant of the initial matrix, determinant of the A. So basically what do you have here? This is the determinant, and for our situation this is just function, scalar function g, and we see that this g is equal to the multiplication of the components of the initial matrix g ij and multiplied by the components of the inverse matrix. So when you consider the variation, you, this is, this g is just this this sum of the products. So you can consider this, this to get the determinant, you should multiply that matrix by this matrix, and then you consider the variation, and this is straightforward because we consider this variable, these components of the inverse matrix as the variables. So, and because we multiplied here by that, we multiply also this by j and this square root, well, you see, yes, here it was in the, it was down and now it is up. So, so this is a simple algebra of matrix, matrices. So you can check it straightforward. So this is the variation of the square root of minus g. And it is for that summand. Okay. So the more correct formula for just two is the following. So you consider the differential of the determinant, and it is equal for the following thing. Okay. So we use that formula for that summand, and what we will have? We will have sum of two one, two, it was because of square root minus two. Then we have the variation of the metric and volume form plus this. So basically here we already have what we wanted. This is the Einstein equation for the vacuum space without any fields. What is left? So of course, what should we show about this summand? That this is what, if we integrate over the whole space, what? Zero. Yes, when some integral over the whole space is equal to zero. Well, it's very standard trick, I think, especially in physics. If you consider the integral over the whole space, you always have some assumption about what happens in the infinity. Nothing happens, because at infinity, anything should goes to zero. This is a standard assumption, I think. So, and basically, what do you usually do when you have this, for example, four-dimensional integral? You want to use some Stokes formula and to integrate instead of the whole space, to integrate over the more and more the bound of some ball that is goes to infinity. Yes, so you can see the very very big ball, and instead of integrating of this whole space, you integrate over this ball. By Stokes formula, you can consider that there is integration only by the bound of the ball. Yes, and as the bound goes to infinity, where everything is zero, so this term is zero. So, but to use Stokes formula, what should you have? Come on, Stokes. So if you have some manifold and you integrate some form, yes, or on this manifold. For example, this was n-dimensional manifold with some boundary. So this was M with some strange topology, possibly n-dimensional, but it has some bound. This is the edge, and it is n minus one dimensional. Yes, so if you integrate some exact form, yes, on it, then what will you have here from the right hand side. So this form was n minus 1 dimensional, yes? When you consider the differential, it will be n dimensional, yes? And so you can, roughly speaking, you can integrate by part. So you can throw this differential here. So this will be edge. This will be n minus 1 dimensional manifold because it is bound of n dimensional manifold. And you integrate this n minus 1 dimensional form on it. So this is more or less Stokes' formula. So because in our case everything will be zero, but in general you have some plus minus here, yes, because of you should be very careful with orientation on your manifold. So basically this is what? This is very, very big generalization for this formula from school, just to give you some very simple. Yes, if you have here, if here was the derivative of some function, what will it be? This will be just function, but on the edge of this interval, yes? So this is just here, so more or less this is the same. Okay, so to use this formula here under the integral, you should have some that is exact, yes? That is some differential of something else. So to finish our calculation, we should find something which which derivative will be equal to this integration function. Once again,
we have not assumed it as a definite integral, right? From starting onwards, it is an indefinite integral. So bounds are minus infinity to infinity. You mean to say?
Yes, yes. So this is the integration by the whole space.
So, so it is from minus infinity to infinity.
But this is integration over the four-dimensional time space. 1, 3. Actually, here you have here. So locally, but not even locally, there you have coordinates here. So the omega actually is equal to dt, dx, dy, dz. So you integrate this. Here you have some scalar functions. All of them depends on these variables, and what do you have? So you can forget about this 1, 3. Consider it just like R4. So you consider in, for example, this is time, this is space. And you consider this ball, yes, in this four-dimensional space. As this integral is the integral all by on the whole space, you can consider this integral as a limit of integrals by some this ball. Depends with radius r, yes, some radius rho, yes, it's four-dimensional ball in four-dimensional space. So this is of the same thing, but as rho goes to infinity. Yes, you just cover your four-dimensional space by the collection of these enlarging balls. If this function that you have in the integral is a divergence of something, then you can, using the Stokes formula, consider not the integral by the four-dimensional ball, but the, this is Stokes.
Stokes formula, usually this was surface integral to the linear integral.
Yes, yes, but there is different generalization of Stokes formula. There is standard formula with rotors, with divergences and so on. But there is a high dimensional generalization for the Stokes formula. So you have, so actually if you have here, which is something is D of something, then, for example, X, then by Stokes, it is equal to the integral of x on the three-dimensional sphere. But as this sphere, it has it everything which happens in x is happens somewhere here, yes, where we are now. But at infinity, nothing happens. So you don't have any perturbations at the infinity. I want to remind that we consider the perturbations of the metric. So we consider only finite perturbation of the metric that is zero at the infinity. So for some big radius rho, this will be zero. There will be no variation here. So what is the crucial moment here is, can we apply Stokes or not? To understand this, we should understand either this function is divergence of something else or not. And now I just will write down some formulas and you will see that it is. Here we will suppose that we also find some good coordinate system in which Christoffel symbols are zero, but its derivatives is not zero. Then what can we do? We can intertwine partial derivatives and our variation, yes? So this is Ricci, and this is commutations of the squares of Christoffel symbols plus the commutation of derivatives of the Christoffel symbols. So we interchange this partial derivative and variation here and get this. Okay. So this is the same. Oh, not the same. You should write down some different index. So you can Okay. You just open the brackets and change some summation index. You change here this summation index k here and here, just to write down this formula. Okay, where this W is actually what we want. So look at the hands, we say in Russia. So we want to prove that this term is a divergence of something. Here we supposed that we found some good coordinate system in which all Christoffel symbols are zero. So what is left in Ricci tensor is only this. Then we intertwine, change partial derivatives and variation here, because they are independent. It is easy to understand. This we consider the variation of by the matrix. So then we open the brackets, change index, nothing interesting, and we get this 4W equals that, where WI is GIK. D gamma L I K minus G I L variation I K. So but here we have standard partial derivative along this ith coordinate. So also we have the summation by this I index. What should we actually have to be more correct? Instead of having partial derivative, we should have covariant derivative, because we should not to forget about our metrical structure. But here we simply forgot about this covariant derivative, because in our good coordinate system at that point we consider this only at a point. At that point, our Christoffel symbols were zeros. So actually, we should have here this to be correct. This is comma with dot. Why do we have here this? So this is okay. So it to understand that this is correct, you should also use some formulas. let us understand that this formula is correct, just to understand that this is true. We should remember how does this the covariant derivative of a vector. Yes, this is because index is up, we have vectors, right? And if this summation, if index I we have here and here, what is that? That is actually the following. So this standard formula from the beginning of this tensorial calculus. And Christoffel symbols, they can be calculated by this formula. Why it is true? Because when some indexes indices coincide, then you this standard formula for the Christoffel symbol can be simplified. So here we have actually it's not a Christoffel symbol, but this is a summation of all Christoffel symbols. Here from the left hand side we have a summation by the index I. So this sum is equal to that. So here you don't see index I. Why is that? Well, it is easy to check that simply by using that formula from about the determinant and so on, that this is true. Okay, so you exactly have these components for the vector W, because here we have a summation over the index I. This formula is true. You see, yes, d logarithm, then you simply divide by that square root, then you consider the derivative of the square root and so on, and 1/2. Okay, so I remind you that this is the simplification of that formula for the Christoffel symbols dg I KL. Here we have DXI, for example, LJ and plus and minus. When you consider the summation of the that indexes, this formula is true. So it is just a simplification of this center formula for the Christoffel symbols. So that equals to that. So this is equals, we can write down like here, and actually this is equal to this formulas. You can check this formula in Landau-Lifshitz, but there are much more formulas than this. So actually there are a lot of calculations here, but everything is fine, I hope. So this covariant divergence, because you see this is just a summation over the index I, and this is a summation of covariant derivative, so you can consider this as the covariant divergence can be calculated using that formula. This is for general vector A. And as we supposed here that the Christoffel symbols is zero at this good coordinate system, and everything here, which is also important, we consider the variance of the tensor. We remember that the Christoffel symbols, they are not tensor, but their difference is tensor, because in this good coordinate system it was all just a partial derivatives, but we consider the variation of the tensors, so we can pass to the covariant derivatives. And that is actually equals to this minus G . Okay, so I'll finish just now. So the integral of that term, the integral of that term is zero, because using that formula we got this. So this is our square root of minus g disappeared, because of it was here we had one root, here we have another root, they disappeared, and what is left is just absolutely standard divergence of this. Yes, so this is standard Stokes formula. Here we have just dt dx3. This is goal you can consider as an integral of the three-dimensional sphere. And with radius rho, and this is goes to zero. So this term is can be forgot. Okay, but after some calculations with Christoffel symbols and covariant derivatives. So if we consider this gravitational action without any electromagnetism, and you variate the most reasonable function is a scalar curvature, you consider the components of the metric as independent variables. Actually they are not independent because the components of the metric tensor is depend on the coordinates at the space. You actually can, you cannot variate your metric independently. Yes, you can variate the coordinates in the space, and this will, so there is dependence between variation of the coordinates and the components of the metric. Okay, but still, what we get is this. So in the space without any fields, our metric, if it minimizes the action of that functional, the metric should be like that. So this is Einstein equations. Empty space, not space but time space. And the solution of this equation is a metric. So it is a really big problem in differential geometry to construct some Einstein metrics, more or less in dimension 4. And if you consider Lorentzian metrics, so one of the, so you have one minus and three pluses, either one plus and three minuses. So more or less is everything is known. So at least locally,
symmetries are used.
Yes, a lot, because if you don't have symmetries, you almost don't have anything. So I think next time, next year, we will calculate Schwarzschild metric, some its characteristics, then maybe Kerr solution, which is, for example, which is true for the rotating black hole. Yes, because Schwarzschild is a solution for the stable black hole, and something else. But I just wanted to emphasize that besides of for this application to the physics, from the geometrical point of view, I'm the geometer, still this very 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 tough equation, because in Ricci curvature you have a lot of different partial derivatives. And if you don't have any if you don't suppose any symmetries for your matrix, if you don't suppose that it doesn't depend on some variable, if you have all the variables, all the components, it is absolutely impossible to find some solutions. This equation is very, very, very non-trivial. But for example, I found some solutions for this equation, but in high dimensions. Okay, so what I wanted to tell also today is just energy impulse tensor. Actually, it's not gravity. Yes. So Okay, it will be very short. And actually, I don't have any good experience with these calculations. But for example, if you consider some another action, which is that lambda is some Lagrangian, and you can write it down using some physical intuition or something like that. So you just consider this variation along these components of the metric, and using by some formulas, you will get this. So this is energy impulse tensor. More or less, it is. It can be simply defined. It can be defined as a variation of the Lagrangian, more or less. Actually, I don't want to to calculate all this stuff. But okay, using something like I used in previous formulas, you can show that this integral is equal to that. Covariant derivative minus g d omega. So also we see that this is covariant divergence. This is our volume form, so that this summand is zero plus that summand. Xi I minus g d omega, where Xi I is variation of our coordinates. So you consider the variation of coordinates, and this perturbation of coordinates is exactly the Xi I. Then using some calculations, you can show that this integral splits into two summands, one of them also the zero because of Stokes, and another is that one. So also the variation of this magnetic, probably M for magnetic or maybe for mass, is equal to that formula. For example, for electromagnetic field, this lambda is equal to minus 16 pi Fik Fik. which is the same. And what is that? This is probably well-known thing for you. So here we have induction. So this is magnetic induction, and this is, how do you call it, electric field. Okay, so if you So this is basically an exercise. So after, when you remember all these constants that actually live here, finally, when you want to get an equation for both for gravitation action and for this magnetic action, you will get the whole Einstein equations, and they are the following. So empty part of the equations, and here we have this magnetic or mass part. So K is gravitational constant. You see there are a lot of different constants here, centimeters, gram, and second squared, minus 8, and C is the speed of light. It is 300 kilometers. Yes. Yes, is it true? How many zeros do you have in C? Centimeters. 300,000. Ah, kilometers. Да. One, two, three, five, six, seven, eight meters. Yes, 300 kilometers. In 1 kilometer, you have 1,000 meters.
If it is in centimeters, 10 zeros.
Yes.
In centimeters, 8 zeros.
In centimeters, 10 zeros. Yeah. Yes, 10 centimeters per second. So, what do you have here? 10 minus 8 multiplied by 10 minus 40, and 3 in the fourth, it will be some kind of almost 100. Yes, so also 2 minus 2, and you have almost 10 minus 50. So basically, you can see that this constant is very, very, very small. And it means that the gravitation is much, much weaker than electromagnetic fields. So this constant is about that. Okay. So, and I will. What also can I say about this? No. So, about this stuff, I am planning to show that, for example, do you know that, for example, Maxwell equations can be considered, you can consider this form. Fij dxi wedge dxj. So you consider this as a two form, yes? And do you know that Maxwell equations is just that fact that this two form is exact? This I will write it down as F. Is exact and not exact, is closed and co-closed. So this is, for example, Hodge star, for those who wanted to hear about it. So this is so well known. Also, there is some operator on the forms, and maybe I will tell about that. Also, there is some analogy with elasticity theory, because for example, do you know that there is some deformation tensor in elasticity theory when you consider some media, some whole body, and you consider stresses, yes, and you can interpret this strengths and some deformations as some curvatures in that body. So there is also, for example, it is very roughly speaking, but do you know that Hooke's law? So there is some linear dependence between one tensor and another, yes? So you can basically, one tensor is the deformation и напряжение. So basically the deformation tensor can be interpreted as a metric, and the strength tensor can be interpreted as a curvature, and they linearly dependent. This is the Hooke law. So it's formally you can see that is lambda, so almost the same, yes. So there is different formulas that they look the same in different sciences. So of course this is you can think that this analogy is very weak, but actually it's not. If you will study this theory, elasticity theory, we have for example academician Godunov in our institute, who is very famous for his results in that sciences, and he was very glad when my scientific advisor finally make him understand what is curvature, and that there is very deep connections between those deformation in plasticity and elasticity theories with some geometrical objects in it. So okay, and what I wanted also to do, so those who are planning to have an exam, yes, and have some mark. Now next time we will meet, yes, this is very important too. So now I want you to think what will be the most optimal date for our next lecture, and those who don't know what to do at the 1st of January, they can think about these questions. So, okay, the first one, find all minimal revolution surfaces. Second, find the isothermic coordinates. Find the isothermic coordinates for which metric with Gaussian curvature k equals to -1, 0, and +1 has the most simple form. This is the second. So this is about surfaces, two-dimensional case. So this is all the minimal surfaces. You remember what is there. This is surfaces for which is its mean curvature is zero. And the task is to find all the revolution surfaces that is which is vanishing mean curvature. Second, on the disk, so locally, this metric should look like something, not dx squared plus dy squared multiplied by some function that is depend on k and x and y. So there is some very preferable and very good coordinates at which this metric with constant curvature has very simple form. This is about solving some elliptic equation. Calculate how many components do RIJKL has. I mentioned that here you have something like n in the power of 4 plus something divided by 12. That's something you should calculate. Force. Okay, it will be the final, I think. Calculate energy impulse tensor for electromagnetic field. This can be done by Euler-Lagrange equation for that Lagrangian that I wrote. Okay, I think it is enough. Just for you to understand how deep is your understanding of the course. So we had 10 lectures out of 15. Yes, So I'm planning to tell Schwarzschild and some another well-known solution for the Einstein equation. Then probably I will illustrate the power of Cartan method. So it is much simpler to use this there is method, some method using some differential forms on Lie groups. Probably I will give some one lecture about spinners, because there is connection between three-dimensional sphere and spinners in space-time. There are connections. Also, I wanted to just these things I actually don't know myself, but I know that there is some Petrov classification of the all for the Einstein matrix. So there is some classifications of the solutions. It is a classification in a point, so not globally. You with this classification you cannot say how does your solutions behave at infinity, or whether it have some singularity and so on. But there is some classification. I think it depends on the symmetries which your space and your metric have. So there will be some interesting, I think, facts. Yes. So, and also maybe I will tell you about some non-physical Einstein matrix, because, for example, probably you have heard about the algebraic geometry. This is very strong, science now, and because you can apply it some algebraic, non-trivial algebraic matrix to construct different things. But the main object, for example, in algebraic geometry is a complex projective space, CPN, or maybe PN. It depends on the notations. And on this space there is Fubini-Studi metric. This is also the Einstein metric, and it is defined on the complex projective space. So, and it has it is Riemannian metric, of course, because all the coordinates that we have here, they all are spatial coordinates. There is no some preferable time direction here, and it is well-known metric. It has some properties, for example, about sectional curvature. There is a lot of different problems in differential geometry concerning this exactly metric, and maybe I will tell also about it. We'll see. Okay, so when will we meet next time? By the way, do you have some exams in January? No?
We don't have exams. Maybe in March or February. March.
At March? Mm-hmm. So, at Monday, next Monday, I will be here at January 9th. So maybe 16.
Or maybe during the term, because people have exams.
You have.
Well, I
Okay, then please write down again all your emails because it will be easier.